Thank you, Jesus. We welcome you in this place today, God. We welcome your presence. If I can have everybody just stand with us today. Hallelujah, Lord. We thank you for this. We thank you for allowing us to be here, Lord, in your presence, Jesus. Hallelujah, 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 Jesus.
Shame is a prison, as cruel as the grave. And shame is a robber, and he's come to take my name. Oh, love is my redeemer, lifting me up from the ground. And love is the power where my freedom song is found.
No grave gonna hold my body down. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. When I hear that trumpet sound, I'm gonna rise up the ground. There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Oh, 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 oh.
The smooth and velvet tongue. Fear is a tyrant, he's always telling me to run. Oh, love is a resurrection, love is a trumpet sound. Love is my weapon, I'm gonna take my giants down.
There ain't no grave gonna hold my body down. Praise. Worthy is the one who has overcome the grave. Let the people dance, let the people sing. Worthy is the mighty King. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy of our praise. Worthy is the one who has overcome the grave. Let the people dance, let the people sing. Worthy is the mighty King. Worthy is the Lamb, worthy of our praise. Worthy is the one who has overcome the grave. Let the people dance, let the people sing. Worthy.
On this Easter Sunday, on this Resurrection Sunday, we thank you, God, because we don't have to live the way we used to live. We don't have to be the way we used to be. God, if you came out of the grave, then I'm walking out of my grave too. Hallelujah. You came that we might have life and life more abundantly. Thank you, Jesus. 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 Amen. Welcome to the Apostolics of Fairbanks 2022 Easter Sunday service. We are thrilled by several things. We are thrilled that every one of you have shown up. And we are thrilled that we have heard previously on good authority that God himself was showing up. So we're all in good company. Amen. To all of our guests, all of our family, all of our friends, we thank you sincerely for being with us today. If you know somebody that would like to experience this, or maybe you know some people that you think would need to experience Jesus on Easter 2020. We are going to be having another service at 2:05. It's just going to be a lot more worship. My kid brother, Tiny, Slim, he is my brother Dion. Anybody that here that knows him, he's going to be doing our message, our play, whatever you'd like to call it today, of this centurion story. And I'm so proud of all the work that he's put into this and his burden and his ability to be dramatic. Out of the two of us growing up, I guarantee you nobody would have labeled him the dramatic one. But today it gets to be him. So thank you for coming out and sharing with us. We are going to be having on our Easter Sunday, and this is not for our guests. I just want you to know that we're going to be giving an offering today for Save Our Children. We do not expect, there's no expectation of you, our guests, to help give today, but this is a national offering that we give for our Save Our Children fund for our Sunday school department nationally and internationally. So we will be doing that here in a little bit. But I wanted to welcome you all here. You're a emergency exits. In the case of an emergency, the rows will not light up. But there is an exit in the back there, and there's one over there. If you see me running, you know it's serious. So follow. Just follow. Our restrooms are back here in the back where it says not an exit. That's Greek for bathrooms this way. Thank you. Thank you for listening to the simple instructions of your flight attendant today. Tip your waiter. No, not really. I do want to thank you all for being here. Our associate pastor, Brother Sam Sperling, is going to come, and he's got a few announcements for us. And we are just looking forward to this next little bit in worship. We are the Apostolics of Fairbanks. People say, what in the world is that? We're weird. We're weird, and we're okay being weird. You look around at people that raise their hands. You expect it at a hockey game, right? I heard a story from a friend of mine in Bible school. She said, we had this guy who came, and he was a huge sports fanatic. And the preacher got up, or the pastor got up, and he was talking about this thing, this Holy Ghost. And this sports fanatic came, first time ever being in church, and he said, that Holy Ghost thing, everybody has it here? And he says, well, pretty much. He goes, I want what they have. And they're like, okay, well, I'm going to lead you in a prayer of repentance, and we're going to pray together. And he goes, I don't know what any of that means. And the pastor looked at me and he says, what do you like? What are your hobbies? He goes, ooh, sports. He goes, okay. So he led him in this prayer of repentance, and he said, now, what I want you to do is I want you to raise your hands in the air, and I want you to pretend that God just got the winning buzzer beater three-point. And the guy's like, oh, I know what that's like. He said he just hit it out of the park the bottom of the ninth for a grand slam for the W. He just returned a punt for a touchdown to win the Super Bowl. The guy almost couldn't contain it. So he raised his hands and he shouted at the top of his lungs, way to go, Jesus! And that was the last thing he said in English. God filled him. You might not understand what's going on today, but that's all right. Just know that you're surrounded by a bunch of weird people that God saved out of a bunch of weird stuff. And it's all right to be weird in my book. Amen. So welcome. Just enjoy yourself. Kick back. If your feet stink, don't take your shoes off, but be relaxed. Enjoy your time today. Brother Sperling.
Praise the Lord, everyone. I'm so excited to be able to see all your beautiful faces this morning. It's a pleasure to be able to be up here. I have a few announcements. There will be a drawing held at the closing of our offering. And the guest cards, you can take those for a drink and give it to the Elevation Youth Stand. It's right in our nursery over here. You can take your guest card and give it to them. They'll give you either having an Italian soda, a Red Bull kicker, or a Lotus energy drink with a great selection of flavors for the whole family. So that's even better. So once again, we're just glad to have you here. We're going to move forward in our service. We're excited about what God is doing today. We love you all. We appreciate you all for coming out today.
This bag of bones. I try with all my might, But I just can't win the fight. I'm slowly drifting, a vagabond. And just when I ran down the road, I met a man I didn't know. And he told me that I was not alone. He picked me up, he turned me around, he placed my feet on solid ground. I thank the Master, I thank the Savior, because he healed my heart.
Get up out of that grave. Get up. of the shore. I trust the power of your word, enough to seek your kingdom first. Beyond the barren place, beyond the ocean waves,
when I walk through the waters, I won't be overcome. When I go through the rivers, I will not be drowned. My God will make a way, so I am not afraid.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
You keep the promises you made.
Hallelujah.
There isn't one that is so I will not lose heart. Here I will lift my arms.
I will not be drowned. My
Amen. Once again, it's so great to worship the Lord, God Almighty, with all of you today. Welcome. God, we welcome you into this place. Not just into these walls, God. But Lord, I invite you into my mind, into my own spirit. God, I know we've got people here that worship in other churches. That's fine. We still serve the same God. And we're here to celebrate you. We're here to celebrate your resurrection, God, some 2,000 years later. We still have not forgotten what you've done for your people. We've still not forgotten the opportunity that you have made for us today, God. And we honor you this day. We honor your sacrifice and we honor your resurrection to show us that though we may be walking through life dead, we too can rise to walk in a newness of life. To rise in a newness of life today. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask that our ushers would go ahead and get prepared. Again, our guests, we are not in any way trying to get you to just come to a church and give us your money. We have realized and seen the power of faithfulness and the giving and the covenant relationship that we have with God. We just can't take away that opportunity to bless God and to be blessed by God. We do have something that we like to do. It's normally my brother who does this, but since he's going to be dramatic today, I'm going to try to fill his capable shoes. We have a few verses that we read, and then we read a prayer and a declaration for our tithing and our offering. Brother Tim, if you would go ahead and put those verses up there. Job 22:28, thou shalt also decree a thing, and it shall be established unto thee. Malachi 3, verse 8, will a man rob God? Yet ye have robbed me. But ye say, wherein have we robbed thee? In tithes and offering. Upon the authority and by the orders of your word I have given, and it shall be given unto me, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. I am a tither and a giver. I bring my tithe and offering today into your storehouse. Therefore, the enemy is rebuked. The curse is broken. I live under an open heaven. You pour out upon me such a blessing that there is not enough room to receive it. We receive jobs and better jobs, raises and bonuses, sales and commissions, benefits and settlements, estates and inheritance, interest and income, rebates and returns, checks in the mail, gifts and surprises, bills paid off, debts dismissed, royalties received. My whole family saved and walking with God. Perfect health, abundance, and to walk in divine favor and blessings. I shall be blessed coming in, and I shall be blessed going out.
And all that you will prosper in Jesus' name.
Amen. And it is so. Amen. During this time, what we normally do is our ushers will come up to the front. We just get out of our seats for the next few minutes and we greet one another. So if you have a stranger coming up to you and telling you their name, go ahead and get it. There will not be a test later. We don't expect everybody to remember everybody else's names. We had to do that because I'm terrible with names. Amen.
Jesus has won.
Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for your faithfulness, to us, God. I know, God, that we're human, and as humans, we just simply make mistakes. So many mistakes, God, that we can get stuck. And sometimes when we ask you to forgive us, God, we don't even allow you to forgive us. We don't even allow ourselves to be forgiven. But Lord, when you come in and we just begin to worship you and your presence just comes in and we feel it, and it just feels so non-judgmental. You are letting us to feel your heart. You're allowing us to feel who you are and what you are. And though we as human beings fail you, you never fail us. And though we do fail at times as people, we continue to strive to be like you. As much as I feel your love in this place today, I pray that every other person, every other man, woman, boy, and girl would feel that love the way that I do. That acceptance, that right to be here, that right to be in your presence. I thank you, Jesus, for this opportunity to be with you. In Jesus' name. Whether you're here at 2204 Discovery Drive or online with us. I just pray that you would experience and feel God's love. His love. His love. His acceptance. The Bible says, if God be for us, who can be against us? The Revelator John was not saying, it wasn't a challenge. He wasn't saying, name the person that's against you. It was kind of rhetoric. And he said, if God be for you, does it even matter who could be against you? Does it even matter? I've done a lot of dumb things in my life. And I don't expect a show of hands if you have done a lot of dumb things in your life. But if God has your back, I mean, there's up and there's down. There's in and then there's out. There's left and there's right. There's good and there's evil. Then there's God. There's just God. I mean, some would say, well, there's God and then there's the devil. No. The devil, he's just an angel. He's not a God. There's God and there's nothing equal to him, and there's nothing evil even equally as bad as he is good. There's just God. Amen. Well, we're going to go ahead and transition right now. I am going to ask that our centurion would make his way out. I don't know exactly where he is or where he's coming from. Or yes, I do. I see him. So if we could get a spotlight, but not on me. Okay, it's time for me to get out of the way.
Greetings, greetings from Rome. I am a centurion of the 10th Legion Fortensis. My name is Longinium, and I'm here to tell you my story. As a child living in Rome, living just outside of Rome in a little city, my parents had installed in me a love for our gods and for our country and a love of warfare. My father was a soldier in the Roman Legion, and I wanted to be like my dad. About the time I was about 10 years old, my dad went to battle and never came back. And I wanted to walk in his footsteps, but I wanted to do more than he did. He never quite made it to the centurion level. And that's something that I wanted so bad. My parents had actually scraped up a little bit of money, and they went to a local blacksmith, and they got me a little suit of armor and a little helmet, but never without the plume. I didn't deserve that. You had to earn that in battle. And we had actually, after my dad had died, one of our neighbors was a centurion, and he kind of took me under his wing and taught me different things, and he made a sword out of wood for me to practice with, and he showed me all the different sword techniques, and kind of started me on my way and helped me get ahead of some things. And it just, ever since I was young, I had such an infatuation with warfare. And I finally was able to join the army, and it was one of the proudest days of my life. I was 17 years old. They allowed me in. I was fit. I was very fit. I worked my tail off from just a little boy. I exercised all the time, constantly doing my push-ups, my calisthenics. And I had just chiseled my body into something. And I was a warrior. Nobody could come against me. I had won every fight that I'd come into. I was tough. I was tough, and I had to be. I had to be. Because I wanted to be a centurion. I wanted to be a leader of the army. I wanted to lead my men into battle. It was probably about 8 years into my career that we headed over to Germania. I was there for 3 years, grueling years of battle. I don't know how many enemy had fallen under me, but we finally had cornered Arminius at the Weser River. And that battle, my, what a battle. 50,000 strong. I don't even know how many they had. They just kept coming. It was like a flow. And I didn't let my sword down once. And I led my men to battle. And I gritted my teeth. And I wish I could have counted, but I just couldn't even count how many men that fell under me. And it was that battle that I earned my plume. And Tiberius, the Caesar at the time, he came and he actually gave me the honor of centurion. And that then became the proudest day of my life. I was a centurion in the Roman army, the greatest army that ever lived. And I was so proud that when I got the call to be in the 10th Legion. See, the 10th Legion was actually formed by Julius Caesar, one of our greatest Caesars, probably about 70 years before. And that was a crowning achievement. A centurion in the 10th. That just was unheard of. It's one of the greatest legions. And maybe I'm a little, sighted, but whatever. I was very proud of my legion. And then they stationed us in this backwater town of Jerusalem in Judea. I was on my way. I was on my way to become primus pilis. I knew I was going to do it. If you don't know what that is, that's basically the general. And you get a seat on the war council. And you get to plan the battles. And that's what I wanted so bad. I knew that's what I really wanted. Now that I'm a centurion, that was the next step. And then Jerusalem. To be a police. Ugh. It was disheartening. And honestly, there was so much hatred for the Jews. I mean, as a Roman, we were trained so hard to hate our enemy. I mean, you can't exactly love your enemy. You're not going to want to defeat him. we were trained to just hate. Everything was about kill, 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 hate, hate, hate. And I hated the Jews. Here I was. I was going to be the elite soldier of the Roman army. Stuck as a policeman with these dogs. And Pontius Pilate, nice guy, but he was a little annoying, to be honest. And he is constantly causing trouble. He would put, okay, we believed in a pantheon of gods. We believed in 12 gods, Jupiter and Juno and Mervis and Mars, which was the god of the war, which was, I devoted my life to Mars because of being the god of war, and he was the god of all the soldiers. But these guys who were talking about how there was only one, and it didn't click to me. How could one God do all this stuff? I mean, created all this stuff and kept control of the agriculture and war and safety and all this stuff. There's no way. There's no way one God could do all that. But these Jews, man, they were relentless in their belief in one God. And we were willing to add it, you know, to our pantheon. We were willing to add it, but they were like, no, you don't just add our God. You abandon all others. And of course, that ain't happening. I can't live without my Mars. I had my little statue in my room, and I prayed to him before every battle. And after every battle, I would go and give my homage to him and Jupiter. One God? Really? And Pilate would put all these little statues all over Jerusalem. And oh my goodness, the storm that he caused. And then he would go, hey, Longinium, take care of him. Really? Really, Pilate? Really? Stop doing it. You're just making him mad. And then I got to go deal with all these angry Jews. And we had to, you know, fight a few of them off. And it was, at that time, it was widespread, but we had learned crucifixion and how to do all that stuff. And I got my training in the crucifixion. I never really liked it. I was like, let me go to battle. Let me just battle people. Let me just kill people. This torture stuff is not for me. But Pilate was, I don't know, he just loved stirring up trouble. Well, he got us into some trouble one day, and man, it was a battle, and there was quite the riot, and we had to put down probably a good 50 people, and we shuffled them off, and man, I was covered with blood. And it wasn't mine. I'm too good for that. But I did get a little one. Just a little. Yeah, whatever. But, yeah, Pilate, he was always causing trouble. And Caiaphas, he was the leader of the religious leaders, and he was constantly in there. Pilate, what are you doing? Take these things down. You're offending us. Well, that fateful day that changed my life, this man was brought into the courts of Pilate by Caiaphas and all these leaders. Well, they wouldn't come in. They said that they would be defiled if they walked into the courtyards of judgment. And they stood outside, and me and Pilate went out there and was like, what's the deal? Who's this guy? What's going on? And they said, his name is Jesus, and he's stirring up trouble. And Pilate said, you deal with him. Why do I have to deal with him? And they said, if he wasn't stirring up trouble, we wouldn't bring him to you. We need you to deal with it. And Pilate didn't want to deal with it. He went in there and he's like, what's your deal? What's your problem? Jesus wouldn't say anything. Kind of had a little bit of respect for the man. He just stood there with all these accusations. And Pilate went back out there, and he was like, you know what? You guys deal with it. I don't have time for this. I don't even know what's wrong. He's like, well, they're stirring up trouble. He's telling people this and that and all this religious stuff. And me and Pilate were just tired of it. He was like, whatever, I'll go talk to him again. So he went in there, and he says, so are you the king of the Jews? And Jesus said, are you asking this for yourself, or did somebody tell you? And I thought that was kind of a funny question. But Pilate got a little upset about it. And he was like, "What did you do? Like, what in the world? They're saying that you are claiming to be the king and all this stuff." And Jesus just stood there. And he found out that he was Galilean. He's like, "Oh, well, maybe Herod will take care of this." So he sends him off to Herod. And so Herod gets him, and I don't know what happened there. They just sent him right back. Herod didn't want to deal with him either. So we were talking to him and doing all this stuff, and it really, we weren't getting anywhere. And the Jews were out there just frothing at the mouth, saying he was guilty and he needed to die. And Pilate kept asking him, what has he done? What has he done that he deserves death? And they started the crowd screaming, "Crucify him, crucify him, crucify him." And you know, it just, I looked at the man, and he just seemed so innocent. He just stood there, just quietly. But you know, you never know about some people. So Pilate said, "You know what? I'm going to give you a chance. I will either release Jesus or I will release Barabbas." Now Barabbas, he was annoying. I'd taken him in 3 or 4 times. And I was like, "Please don't release Barabbas again. This guy, I'd gotten my licks on him a couple times. He was trouble." So we pulled out Barabbas, and they were like, "Yeah, release Barabbas and kill this guy." And they started screaming, "Crucify him, crucify him, crucify him, crucify him." Pilate was not wanting to crucify this guy. He just couldn't see it. He said, "There's nothing wrong with this guy. This guy is good. I don't know what your deal is. You kill him." And the Jews said, "No, you have to kill him. It's in our law that we can't kill him on the Sabbath or near the Sabbath." And so Pilate got some water and he washed his hands and he said, "You know what? I'm innocent of this blood. You can crucify him and I'll give the order, but I'm innocent of this guy's blood." And they said, "Fine, let his blood be upon us and on our family, on our children," which was pretty bold. I don't know what the guy had done, but he made them Jews really mad. The only thing I had heard that he had healed people. I don't know what the crime is in that. But they finally, Pilate thought it was a joke to call him king of the Jews, and he just kept saying, you sure you don't want me to release the king to you?" And they were saying, "There's no king but Caesar. There's no king but Caesar." And Pilate knew that they were jealous of the guy. And that's the only reason why, because he just destroyed their whole belief system. But he released them, and they took him to be scourged. Now, scourging was quite the ordeal. This is kind of a representation. This is a whipping post. They would strip the man naked. And I remember they stripped Jesus naked completely, which was enough to really embarrass somebody. And they took the flagrum. And a lot of times they would take pieces of bone and shards of metal and stuff and weave it into the whip. And then the lectern, which, those guys were crazy. Those guys were crazy. They were bloodthirsty. But they would take these flagrums and they took this and whipped Jesus. And when somebody's condemned to death, the scourging was so much worse. The Jews would never allow us to do more than 39 stripes, but with a death sentence and a crucifixion coming up, pretty much the lectern could go until he was tired. And those guys trained daily. They would take cows and they would whip them. But to watch, these guys would get into a rhythm. And it was, I know the guy, he was a bloodthirsty monster, really. I had fought with him. But to see the display of hate, and he just whipped and whipped and whipped. And the first few would just bruise the back and the shoulders, and they'd move down past the buttocks into the legs. And it was just bruising, but then soon enough, after a few more, it would start to cut into the skin. And then after a few more, it would begin to go deeper and deeper until pretty soon the skin was just hanging off and there was meat just hanging off of their back and their legs, and they would try to get around the front at times. And we called it the half death because it was brutal. And they would do their best, and they would bet each other. I'm telling you, these guys were bloodthirsty. They would bet each other to see what kind of spray and blood mist they could make. And by the time they were done with this Jesus, he was just a bloody mess. And at the time, we thought it was a game, you know, to mock the Jews. Pilate had started calling him King of the Jews, and so I threw a robe over him, and some of the men had gotten some thorns, and these thorns, they were huge. And they twisted it up and made a little crown. And at the time, it was funny. We put this crown of thorns on his head, gave him a scepter, put that robe on him, and we bowed down to him and mocked him. And they took the scepter out of his hand and began to beat the thorns into his head. It was brutal. It was brutal. But he was just another man, just another criminal to us. And he deserved it, as far as we knew. I mean, I was in there. I didn't really think he deserved it, but then we put him before the people and said, look, here's your king. Bloody mess. He had blood coming down into his eyes, and he had been spit on and slapped and punched. He was bruised all over. Some of the whips had gotten into his face, and he had ripped some of his cheek off. He was a mess. And at this point, already it had been one of the brutalest crucifixions I'd ever been a part of, and we hadn't even crucified him yet. He hadn't even passed the scourging yet. Then we gave him his cross, which was just the patibulum. The stipe was already mounted out on the hill where we did all our crucifixions. But this thing, it was just rough wood. They weighed about 100 pounds, give or take. At this point, when I first saw Jesus, he had already had blood on him, and he looked exhausted. And I found out later that they had grabbed him the night before, so he'd been up all night, and he had already been up half the day. It was close to 2 or 3 o'clock by the time we got to after the scourging. and he just couldn't, he couldn't carry the cross. And we just grabbed this man. I found out later his name was Simon. But we grabbed him out of the crowd and made him carry the cross. And we made them walk up to Golgotha. And, you know, we took care of the two thieves that were going with him. And Jesus just kind of fell over. And we put the patibulum down, and he just put his arms out and let us nail his hands in. And we found, the Romans found a way. There's a nerve in this wrist here. And if you sever that nerve, it's extremely, extremely painful. And I had seen people in battle that had lost their hands, and you just barely breathe on them. And that nerve is just, they would scream in pain just breathing on that little nerve, and that nail would drive right there in between the bones. And our nails were, I don't know, they're about this long, and they were squared off. It was intense pain, and they screamed and screamed and screamed. We got both arms in, and then me and one of my guys grabbed the cross and set it up on the stipe, and then took his feet. And it's the same thing in the feet. There's a little nerve in there in the feet. Drive the nail right into there. It doesn't cause much blood, but man, it's painful. We put his feet together and stuck that nail through his feet. And then the whole idea of the crucifixion, we'd have him hanging just right so that everybody could look right into his eyes. And it really was a deterrent. We were just trying to let people know this is what's going to happen if you're a criminal. And I remember we got him up there, and we parted his clothes, and some of the guys were casting lots. It was like, I want a piece of this king of the Jews. I want a piece of his clothing. And he looked down at us and looked around. And I'll never forget. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. And that, there was something in that that broke something in me. Everything I'd done to the man and mocked him and all these things. And here we were killing this man who Pilate felt was innocent. And he was forgiving me? It didn't make sense. It didn't make sense. But it clicked something in me. And I looked at the man. And I looked him straight in the eye, and he looked straight at me. And it was different. It wasn't like any other man I'd ever killed. It wasn't like any other man I'd ever tortured. He actually loved me. And I had to hold it together because something broke in me. I saw love in the eyes of a man that I was killing. And at that moment, I wanted to pull him down from the cross. I wanted to take him to the best doctor and heal his wounds and make it all right. And I knew it was too late. This man loved me. After everything we'd done to him, he loved me, and he was willing to forgive me. There was a few more things going on, and the thieves were mocking the man, and one of the thieves was mocking the man. The other one was saying, hey, we deserve this. We deserve this, man. This guy didn't deserve this. He was a teacher. He was a rabbi. And he told Jesus, he said, please remember me. Remember me when you go to your kingdom. And Jesus, with all, at this point, he was rasping and blood was coming out of his mouth. And blood, he was covered in blood and gore. And he looked over at this man and took the time in his dying to say, today you will be with me in paradise. I didn't really understand what that meant. I didn't know the man. I don't know what he teaches. I don't know. But I remember in the trial, Pilate whispering something that the Caiaphas had said about him being the Son of God. This Jewish God. And this man was loving, attentive to those around him, even in his death. This isn't a normal man. This isn't somebody that deserved death. There was something different about him. And then he looked down at his disciple. What I found out later was John was one of his disciples, and his mother was sitting there watching him. And I couldn't stomach it just to think about my mother looking at me like that. And I tried to get them to leave, and they wouldn't leave. They wanted to see. They wanted to see what was going on. And he looked down, and he said, behold thy son. Behold thy mother. Still, after all this time of suffering, he was attentive to others. And I'd never seen that kind of love. I'd never seen that kind of care. I was a warrior. We didn't have that. I mean, my parents loved me, but I've never seen that kind of love. I couldn't reconcile it. Here is a man dying on a cross. It's my fault. I'm the one doing this, and he's forgiving me and loving me. And then he said, my God, why have you forsaken me? And it stirred me. And I didn't know what to do. I just stood there and watched, like everybody else, and just watched him die. And he would raise himself up, and his back was just bloody, and it would rub up against the rough wood of the cross and open all his wounds once again. He'd rasp out a few more words. He said something about being thirsty, and so we gave him some vinegar, and he refused it. And then he said, as he was hanging there, it is finished. God, into thy hands do I commit my spirit. And then he lowered his head and died. He died on his own terms, because he still had hours of suffering to go. The other thieves, they were still screaming and yelling in pain and gurgling over their blood that was in their lungs already. Pilate had brought the order down to go ahead and break their legs, to let them die. And the men took the spear and started smashing at the calves and at the shins of the thieves, broke their legs. When we got to Jesus, I already knew he was dead. He looked dead. And his eyes were open. And I'll forever remember that face. I'll forever remember that face. I told the men not to break his legs. And they grabbed a spear and it's just under the fifth rib. They shoved it in there. Pulled it out. Blood and water were pouring out, which was the sign to us that he was sure dead. Which was different than most other crucifixions that we'd ever done. I had never seen anybody die that way. But we called it the broken heart. The man had died of a broken heart. And I'm the one who did it. And I questioned my life. I questioned everything that I had ever known. I questioned my gods. I questioned the orders. I questioned my government. I questioned everything. As the man had died, the sky went dark, and there was a great earthquake. And I said, surely this man is innocent. Surely this man is innocent. He truly was the Son of God. He truly was the Son of God. And in my shame, I walked away. And I've never been the same again. This is the end of my story. But this is not the end of the story. Sir, would you finish the story?
Would you all just close your eyes as we have just heard a centurion's story? I want to take you back on a trip before we can get to the resurrection of Jesus. Everywhere Jesus went, he was bringing life to those who had no life. He was bringing hope to those who had no hope. People who were broken were drawn to Jesus, and vice versa, Jesus was drawn to them. You see, Jesus was set to fulfill his purpose in his ministry. Nothing was going to stop him fulfilling his ministry. Because the fact be known that in order for Jesus to fulfill his ministry, he knew what was going to befall him. He knew the one day that they would hail him and they would worship him and praise him. But he also knew that there would come a day where those who praised him and hailed him and recognized him will be those whose joys would turn into sorrows as it was leading him to be crucified. Jesus was well aware. After all, he had all power in heaven and earth. He could have stopped at any time, but you have to realize something, that what kept Jesus pursuing his ministry was not the beatings, was not the nails, but the reason Jesus fulfilled his ministry was because he loved you and he loved me. When we were unlovable, love kept him on the cross. He paid a debt that he didn't even owe. In other words, it should have been you and I today in this room who should have went upon that cross. But Jesus simply took our place on the cross. What's so amazing about Jesus is the Bible says, while we were yet sinners, before we even knew who he was, he had already died for us. Oh, they thought the story was over when they crucified him and they gambled at his feet and they made fun of him. They mocked him. They ripped the flesh off his bones. But what's so amazing about Jesus is he never said a word. Never said one word, because the only thing that was on his mind was you and me. Oh, they took him off the cross and they took him down to a borrowed tomb, rolled the stone from the tomb because they knew that it was over. They knew that we wouldn't have hope, no chance of salvation, no chance of redemption. But just when they thought it was over, just when hell put a period at the end of the story, Jesus says, comma, that's not how the story ends. Amen. To a people who had no hope, 3 days later, he rose from the grave with all power in his hand. And that same Jesus walked in this building today to let somebody know, you may not have hope, but I'm here to give hope to the hopeless. You may not have salvation, but the Bible said he's come to seek and save that which is lost. You're never too far gone where his blood can't reach you and cover your multitude of sins. Amen. Doesn't matter how society has labeled you. Jesus said, I'm coming today to seek and save that which is lost. Would you stand on me this afternoon and all throughout the building? While you're standing, I want you just to join me today, because you're surrounded by people from all different backgrounds. None of us are perfect. Some of us were ex-alcoholics, drug dealers. The fact be told, we're all sinners saved by grace. Didn't have a relationship with God, didn't even know who God was. But there came a day when we walked into a service like this. Might have not been an Easter service, but we walked into a service like this where somebody told us that there's a God, amen, who can forgive you of your sins. There's a God who can make you white as snow. There's a God who wants to take you where you are and put you where you need to be. Oh, we were messed up, bound by sin, addicted to drugs. Society labeled you as an outcast. Your home was a wreck. There was still no real joy on the inside. Oh, we had a smile, but we were wrecked. We were messed up. And we brought all those problems here today. We brought all the situations that life has dealt us here today. But we stopped feeling something. We felt something we've never felt before. Oh, you may have strayed away from God, and you may have walked away, but hear me, he's never left you. He's never forsaken you. You start feeling something. You feel something that you've never felt before. Because hear me, Jesus can heal you in any moment. But it's not the healing that he's concerned about. Oh, no, it's not putting you back together. He can do that at any moment. But there's something that goes deeper today. Something goes deeper that the eye cannot see. But he's concerned about the soul, because the soul will live forever somewhere. Oh, you can wrap it around this world, and the Bible says that no man can serve two masters. We can forsake him on the cross, and we can serve other gods. But he said, choose you this day whom you're going to serve. So this same Jesus, we walk into a place like this where the atmosphere's right. And I remember walking to a church one morning, having not known Jesus, didn't even want a relationship with God. But you see, there's something about when God begins to draw a person. Something when God begins to knock on your heart because you've tried everything else and everything else has failed. And I remember coming to an altar. I remember repenting of my sins, laying everything down that was not of God, having a determination that I'm going to serve Him. I remember listening to that preacher stand up on the day of Pentecost, and he stood up and he said, there was a man in the book by the name of Peter who had the keys to the kingdom. He stood up on the day of Pentecost because the Bible says that he's talking to a bunch of Roman soldiers, centurions, because the scripture says if they had known who Jesus was, they wouldn't have crucified him. And now they have the audacity to ask this man, men and brethren, what must I do to be saved? I just crucified Christ, and now you want to ask me what it takes to be saved? But I'm so glad Peter didn't pick and choose who had the right to go to heaven. But Peter looked at these men who were broken, these men whose heart had been ripped out, and he said, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of your sins. And ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For it is a promise unto you and unto your children and to many that are far off, as many as the Lord our God shall call. 3,000 souls every single day repent of their sins. We're baptized in Jesus' name and filled with the Holy Ghost. I want you to know that I'm one of those who were down to nothing, didn't deserve mercy. I didn't deserve love. But when nobody else loved me, He had a love for me. When nobody else cared for me, God was there caring for me. And I went down to an altar to repent of my sins, was baptized in Jesus' name, and was filled with the Holy Ghost. And I've never been the same since that day. He paid a price. He paid a debt that we cannot repay. No amount of money, no amount of fame can repay the debt that He paid, not just for me, but He paid for you. Before I end every service, I always like to tell the congregation, no matter where I'm preaching, I always tell them, would you just join me and raise your hands? And what are you saying, preacher? I'm saying this, that when you raise your hands, that means, Lord, I'm surrendering myself to you. I've tried everything else. Everything else has failed. But right now, Lord, I'm going to surrender myself because You can do better with my life than I can my own self. I've tried everything else and it seems like it's not working. But Lord, today, right now, in this moment, I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. I can't fix what happened yesterday. But Lord, right now, in this space of grace that You've given me, I'm going to give You a chance. So I wonder if you'll just join me right now before we go any further. If you'll just lift your hands and say, Lord, today I'm going to give You a chance. I'm tired of being hurt. I'm tired of being confused. Lord, I'm tired of running. But Lord, today I'm going to give You a chance. I want You to come, God, and change my life today, Lord. I'm going to serve You for myself today. Come on, somebody, would you join me and just lift your hands right now in this building? There are hands raised all throughout this room. Front and the back, left to right, everyone, their hands that are lifting in this. You may not know Jesus, but He wants to know you today. He's going to give you a love, a peace that will surpass all understanding right now. He's coming right to where you are. You don't have to be perfect. You don't have to get right to serve God. You just come to him as you are, and God works from the inside out, and he'll give you a peace that will surpass all understanding. Come on, would you just lift your hands right now in the building? There are hands raised all throughout this place, front to back right now. That's it. Now, while you got your hands raised, I want to know if you'll just talk to him. Lord, I'm sorry. We're going to make this place an altar right now. I'm not going to ask you to come to this altar yet, but before you come, I want you to make an altar right in your seat. An altar is a place where things die. An altar is a place where you lay things down and you vow to never pick them up again because you want your life to be changed for the good. So I wonder right now if you'll just lay some things down right where you're sitting. You don't have to confess nothing to me. Jesus knows right now. Come on, that's it. Just lay some things down right now, Lord. Listen, some of you who've already been born into the kingdom, if you see somebody beside you, why don't you pray with them? Let them know you're not in this by yourself. I'm praying for, I love you. Come on, help somebody right now. Right now, come on. That's it. Lift your hands, lift your hands. Lift your hands. Lift your hands. There you go. Lift your hands. Now here's what we're going to do. I know we got over 100 plus. But I'm going to open this altar right now. If you're here in this building today, the Lord's been moving in a mighty way, dealing with hearts as we speak. If you're here in this building, listen, you've never repented of your sins. You've never been baptized in Jesus' name. We can get that done today. The Bible says if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Behold, all things are passed away, and behold, all things have become new. That means when you're buried with Christ in baptism, you die out to the old man. And you raise up in the newness of life. And he promises you that he'll fill you with the gift of the Holy Ghost. And you'll speak in tongues as the Spirit of God gives you the utterance. Because God realized that you'll never win a spiritual battle in your flesh. He says, so I'm going to give you power in the Holy Ghost. So right now, while they get ready to sing, I'm going to open this altar. And I pray you don't come by yourself this morning. If you're a guest of ours, grab your family by the hand. Bring them to the altar. Listen, if you've lost your way and you're trying to find your way back home, there's no other time, there's no other opportunity than to reach out and grab his hand and let his mercy lead you to a place where you'll die out to the old man and God will raise you up in the newness of life. Come on, you don't have to be ashamed today. We all have to come to the foot of an old rugged cross, and there's still room at the cross today for you. Come on, grab somebody's hand. Grab somebody's hand. Hallelujah. Grab somebody's hand. That hand that you got a hold of, why don't you take that hand and lead them to this altar today? God's going to change their life today. God's going to give them joy today. Come on, ma'am. Come on, sir. You don't have to wait. You don't have to be shy. You don't have to be timid. God's reaching for you right now. Come on, that's it. God, we love you today. We love you today. We can't do this by ourselves. We need Jesus to come in and not just touch us, but we need God to change us this morning. Come on, lift your hands where you are right now in this place. That's it. Lift your hands and let God touch you right now. Come on, ma'am. Come on, sir. You may not want to come to this altar, but if you'll lift your hands right now, he'll come to right where you are. Come on, he'll come to right where you are today. He's coming to right where you are, ma'am. He's coming to right where you are today, sir. Come on. He wants to come to where you are today. He wants to come into your shame today. He wants to come into your disappointment. He wants to come into your mind today. Come on, come on, come on. Come on, lift your hands in this building. As it, lift your hands and let the Lord touch you this morning. God, we love you. Come on, somebody, just talk to him. We can't make it without him. He loved you in spite of your hurt. He loves you in spite of your shame. He loved you in spite of your guilt today. Come on, that's it. Come on, that's it. That's it. Come on, somebody. Lift your voice. Let him know that you love him. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, ministers. Hallelujah, Jesus, right now. Somebody, he's giving you direction today. He's calling your name today. He's calling your name today.
Devil from hell can mock what God shut in. No devil from hell can stop what God has started. Oh, 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 oh. When God gives you a word, it's ever settled. It's ever settled. No devil from hell can block what God has promised.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
When God opens the door, no one can shut it. No one can shut it. No devil from hell can stop what God has started. Oh, 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 oh. When God gives you a word, it's ever said. No one can shut it. No one can shut it.